Hello, my name is Paul Barker. My wife Alice and I bought this house in 2016. We particularly liked the backyard, but we soon discovered that it was enchanted by fairies. Yep, you heard correctly, fairies. At least two kinds thus far. It happened like this. I was working in the yard one day when I heard a distant cry for help. I had trouble telling from what direction it came. Finally, I spotted a small balloon trapped in the trees along the fence. So I grabbed a folding ladder and I climbed up to see what I could. The balloon seemed to be made of scraps of varnished silk. In the gondola, which was made from a walnut shell, was a tiny little man.
Help! Help me! I'm all tangled up in this varnished jump. Oh, woe is me!
This is Stugatz. Over time, he became my ambassador to the fairy realm and the creatures that he called the fae folk. He said a sudden downdraft had thrown him into the trees while he was cruising over Evanston looking for new farmland for his family, which consisted of his wife, Periwinkle, and 11 children, and his brother-in-law, Muddle, and sister Cloverleaf, who had only 7 children. He liked our yard because of the high fence on both sides. He asked if we owned a cat, and I said no. He asked if we ever had problems with raccoons or skunks or possums. No, I said. Good, he said. This could work out nice for all of us. You mean your family, I asked. And my friends, he added. Only later would I find out that his friends included a wide variety of magical characters. Under Stugatz's directions, I re-landscaped the yard. I dug out a pond. I piled up the dirt to create hills. And I built a stone farmhouse big enough for 2 families with a small barn to house the beetles that they used to pull their plow. After 2 years, his farm had become quite well established and productive. Eventually, I asked about his friends. He said they included the usual fae folk, standard fairies and pixies, elves and gnomes, as well as a few trolls. When I looked worried about this, he said, "The trolls are quite harmless, really. Mostly just bluster. They're far too slow to catch the pixies, and the standard fairies will keep them in line." He told me that he had been explaining the merits of my backyard to his friends, and they were all interested in moving in. "What else would I need to build?" I asked. "More hills? A waterfall?" "Well," he said, "trolls need a bridge to hide under, and the cave nearby, in case of a flash flood, say. And fairies would need a forest, preferably an indoor forest, because of winter, and to keep out the squirrels. They like hollow stumps and logs. My gnome friends would need a small village, maybe 6 buildings. Oh, and a windmill for grinding pine nuts and acorns and other seeds into flour." This is when I learned to be careful when making agreements with the fae folk. The only indoor space available was part of my art studio in the garage. So when our state governor issued a stay-at-home order because of the pandemic a few months ago, I realized I might have time to build a forest, a haven for my small friends. This is how it turned out. We're standing in a dry stream bed where you can see by their roots that have been eroded by the water that fully half of the tree is underground out of sight. If you look up there, you'll see there's a full moon too. Fairies love to dance under a full moon. And you can see that the stream runs from back there, underneath those arching roots, and it bends and runs off in that direction where you can see a beaver dam. The dam causes this little valley back here to fill up and become a pond with a beaver lodge in the center and secret entrances and exits under the water. Here's the stump of a tree chewed down by the beavers. We'll come back to this later. You see this strange face in the old oak tree? Look below it and you'll find one of the trolls. This one's name is Morgus the Terrible. He gave himself that title. He has a reputation for tearing up the prettiest flowers he can find, hoping to scare the fairies. Sort of like a gorilla pounding his chest. Looks like he's found some bones, maybe of a ground squirrel or something, to make himself look even scarier. But fairies appear to have placed a magic frozen spell on him, probably for his misbehavior. Let's go back to the stump. If you look inside this hole, you can see the glowing pixies inside. They're the smallest of all the flying fae folk. One way you can tell a glowing pixie from a firefly is that the pixie's glow stays on constantly and can change colors. Their glow also generates heat, so they don't need to cover up with moss when they sleep in groups. Their talent, or their job, if you will, is to help with insects and with the underground communications between trees by way of their roots or the network of mushroom roots called mycelium. If I lift off the top of this mossy log, there might just be... Oh, look, there's a special surprise. It's a visitor from Hawaii called the Minahuni. And on the Hawaiian Islands, they are famous as builders of stone walls and roads. This one seems to be dressed for a luau, which is like a feast with dancing. Fairies like to hide when they sleep, under leaves like this. I'm going to carefully remove them. Yes, here is a regular-sized woodland fairy. Their main job or talent is helping small forest animals. This one in front with the red hair and the blue body paint seems to be from the Celtic culture of Ireland. And this other one, the black one with the cloth turban, called a chignon, she's from sub-Saharan Africa. These fairies seem to be from all over the world. This big tree stump is what I call the pixie castle. We can see that these large mushrooms have been hollowed out by the pixies with windows cut through the walls. The windows seem to be narrow enough to protect them from any trolls. Now let's look around in back of the pixie castle. You see that fairy ring of luminous mushrooms? And there with the wings, that's the queen of the pixies. She's sitting awfully still, maybe meditating. Maybe hoping that if she sits very still, we won't notice her. Moving across this log bridge, we come to the gnome village. I don't know what this little structure is. Maybe it was a toll booth for using the bridge. But I know the next building is a silo for storing grain produced by the windmill at the other end of town. This next one is a house with a yellow door. Stugat says they're a very nice, reasonably sized family. Then we go across what they call the no-troll bridge, because it's too small for a troll to hide under. And we see the orange door house occupied by Grungstumple, a grumpy old gnome who constantly complains about the children using his lift here for a swing. I think this little structure with the red door must be the privy. The next house with the blue door houses Grindelstone the Miller, who operates the windmill next door. And finally we have the windmill, with turkey flight feathers for sails. They mostly use the grindstones to make flour from acorn and meal from pine nuts. The gnomes' tummies are so small that a normal-sized pine cone can feed this village for a week if they can get it before the squirrels do. Hey, look over here. That must be the fellow doing all the hooting we heard. And oh, look down there, right below him. This is a bracket mushroom, sort of like a shelf. But this one is called a turkey tail fungus, and it's one of the biggest I've ever found. Look at all the colors. There are no two of them exactly alike. Once they've been dried out, they also have medicinal uses, according to Stugatz. Well, look, we've been inside the forest so long that night has fallen, and that means the pixies might treat us to one of their spectacular aerial ballets. I have a piece of music queued up, which they seem to really like. Let's see what happens. Thank you. Now I'd like to address all of you parents and other grown-ups who have lost your belief in fairies and gnomes. Remember what the hippie philosopher Ashley Brilliant said. So many impossibilities turn out to be true that it might be safer if we all believe everything. Or as Albert Einstein himself said, the universe is not only stranger than we imagine, but stranger than we can imagine.